Hi everyone, and welcome back to the second part of Lesson 9, Level 3. Let's build on the complex case that we started in the previous video, where we had these three factories producing Ken's lava lamps as fast as they can in order to meet the demand in the marketplace. In the last video, we had 1,300 lamps produced in the three factories in Long Beach, Peoria, and Providence, 500 from Long Beach, 475 in Peoria, and 325 in Providence. Over here in column A, those are our eight distribution centers that will distribute all of the lamps to the individual retail shops in their geographic area. Here are the quantities that were originally requested. We can see that we've produced 1,300 and only have a demand of 1,277, so we have a surplus here. Who gets the surplus? We found in the last video that Nimrod got the 23 extra because they had the cheapest shipping price by far of $20.25 from Long Beach. Let's say that we want to add some automation to this sheet and have any DCs that get anything extra to automatically have their DC location cell turn green. We could just eyeball which one is greater, this versus this, this versus this, this versus this, and then paint it green manually, but that's a little brittle and we'd have to be redone every run of the solver model. Also, while that solution might work for eyeballing these eight cells, that would hardly be a fun thing to do if there were 100 rows or 100,000 rows for that matter. There are a few ways to do this, but here is my preferred way. Let me go up to the top here in B5 and go into Conditional Formatting, New Rule, use a formula to determine which cells to format. Now in the formula cell, this is where the magic happens. I just click on I5 greater than B5, format, fill, green, OK. Now before I hit OK and get out of here, I see that Mr. Wizard has been kind enough to absolutely reference the cells in this formula. That would be fine if I wanted this to only work for row 5, but I'm going to want to copy this formatting down to all these other cells. And if they're absolutely referenced in here, then I'll have to do the same process 8 times for all 8 of those rows. Hashtag boo! To save myself some work, let me take all of these dollar signs out of this and then hit OK. Now I can click on B5, go up to the Format Painter, and then click on all these other DCs and voila! You should always test it, so make sure you go over here to Tightwad and add one more to Peoria. And there you go, the fill color changes for us. Now let me get Control Z to get back to perfection. Now it's time for reality to step in. The folks down in Slick Poo just realized that they forgot an order from their most important retailer and they need to up their order from 50 to 100. This means that we now no longer have enough inventory to meet our demand. Our total available is still 1,300, but our demand now is 1,327. So now we have a shortage of 27 lava lamps. Uh-oh, how do we handle this? Since this sheet is all working, and I don't want to mess it up, I'm going to create a copy of it to handle this additional scenario. Holding the Control key and dragging this sheet over here does that for me. So now if I go here to this new sheet, and make sure that Slick Poo has the correct value of 100 in it, run the existing solver model, we don't get any answer report, and there's no longer a feasible solution. Hashtag fail. The good news is that we can still use Solver to make the best of this scenario, but who do we want to be short on their order and place their shortage on backorder? Since it's our job to minimize our cost, that's how we're going to let Solver answer this for us. To do this, we're going to create an empty factory here in both of these ranges, the shipping costs from the factory as well as the number shipped over here. You can think of it as a column that Solver will use to figure out how much to backorder from where, but the preferred way of dealing with this is to think of it as a plant that will produce a certain number of empty boxes of nothingness that will therefore cost nothing to ship. Most folks will add the columns here in between columns E and F, and again over here in I and J. We can do that, but if you put it there, all of the formulas will have to be redone as well as all of the solver constraints. See? Here in column K, this cell only refers to J through I. The sum product formula also needs adjusting. Looking into the solver model, you'll also see that all the constraints need to be reworked as well. So rather than do all that extra work, Let's save a whole bunch of time and remember back to lesson one videos where if we insert a new column or row in the middle of an existing range in a formula, as opposed to on an outside cell, then all the formulas will automatically adjust themselves. Let me undo all this other stuff and get back to here. If I insert columns here in between Long Beach and Peoria in both of these areas, we now see that all of the formulas correctly expanded their cell ranges appropriately. The solver model also adjusted everything, so there's nothing to do at all other than put in the cost of zero for the shipping empty cases. And we then need to create our empty column formulas down here in rows 13 and 16. Lots of folks forget to do that. I can do this by copying and pasting, but I'll just use these fill handles to drag the formulas over. The last question will be for this cell, I-15. What's the initial inventory for our empty factory? I know that I need 1,327, and I also know that my total shipped is 1,300. The difference, or the amount that we're short, is 27, so that is the number you can put here in H15. You could put 27 in there, or if you want it to be a flexible formula, you can take this cell and subtract these other three cells from it, but I'm not sure if you really gained anything since this new formula is pretty brittle and would calculate the wrong answer if almost anything changed anywhere in the model, so I'll leave it just hard-coded as 27. So what do we need to change in our solver model? Has anything really changed? Let me go back into it and look it over. The objective cell, L13, that's still cool. My changing cells are still G5 through J12. I still want K5 through K12 to be greater than B5 through B12. I want to update these values over here in column A of the constraints table to reflect our new reality, but that's a minor thing. Instead of F through H16 being equal to 0, we now need G16 through J16, and looks like Solver caught that as well. We didn't have to change a thing. Since the model didn't need to change, there isn't any need to save the model over here either. The existing model that saved still works. Lots of good news to go around. So let me run the solver again, and we see that 2-egg Florida got shorted. Since it's your job to minimize the cost regardless of any other extenuating circumstances, then this is the correct answer. If the sales and marketing team wants to spread this shortage around across some of the DCs, that's on them, but will increase their shipping costs. Now let me turn the shorted distribution centers red, like we did earlier in the video, for back when we had a surplus. Highlight bug tussle, go back to conditional formatting, make a rule, let's see, what will this be rule, what will this rule be, H5 greater than 0, take out any dollar signs, format with a red fill and a white font, okay. Click on the format painter and paint it onto all those other cells, and there you go. I'll see you in the next video where we, using Solver of course, explore how to assign tasks to individuals in what's generally called, go figure, an assignment problem. See you then and there.